Well, we're glad you're here today. I trust that you've come looking for a blessing from being in the house of the Lord. Now, I am leading the music today because Pam was sick and I didn't want to call anybody and at the last minute. And I told some of the people today, if I knew I was going to do the music, I wouldn't have picked these songs. And so anyhow, I get back for that. But anyhow, we're glad you're here. And I trust that you've come for one reason, and that's to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. A few announcements that I want to remind you about this afternoon at right after service. We will have our quarterly business meeting. We want you to stay for that and be a part of that. And then at next Sunday was scheduled to have fellowship after potluck after services next Sunday, but we are canceling that till March the 3rd. Is that correct? March the 3rd. So remember that also. Not next Sunday, but March the 3rd. One more month away before we get to eat. Okay? So anyhow, y'all be praying about that also. Thank you for being here today, and I trust that you'll receive a blessing from being in God's house. May we pray together. Our Father God, I thank you for your marvelous love and how you love us, God, and how you just fill us with your joy. And God, I thank you that you give us peace in our hearts and our lives. I thank you, God, to how you minister to us and give us strength. And Lord, today as we go into this service, I pray that you will give us strength. I pray, God, that your word will be taught and your word will be preached and your word may be sung, and that people might get excited about glorifying you, honoring you. And Lord, especially I pray, God, that as we come and get filled in our hearts what you want us to do, I pray, God, that we'll depart from this place to serve you, to put you first, foremost, in our lives. And we'll be careful to give you all praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, let's stand together. And we're going to sing, "This is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." Aren't you glad this is the day that the Lord has made? And we can rejoice. We can be excited about what He is doing. You may be seated. A mighty fortress is our God.
In Genesis, Jesus is the ram at Abraham's altar. In Exodus, He's the Passover lamb. In Leviticus, He's the high priest. In Numbers, He's the cloud by day and pillar of fire by night. In Deuteronomy, He's the city of our refuge. In Joshua, He's the scarlet thread out Rahab's window. In Judges, He is our judge. In Ruth, He is our kinsman redeemer. In 1 and 2 Samuel, He's our trusted prophet. And in Kings and Chronicles, He's our reigning king. In Ezra, He is our faithful scribe. In Nehemiah, He's the rebuilder of everything that is broken. And in Esther, He is the Mordecai, sitting faithful at the gate. In Job, He's our redeemer that ever liveth. In Psalms, He is my shepherd and I shall not want. In Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, He's our wisdom. And in the Song of Solomon, He's the beautiful bridegroom. In Isaiah, He's the suffering servant. In Jeremiah and Lamentations, it is Jesus that is the weeping prophet. In Ezekiel, He's the wonderful four-faced man. And in Daniel, He is the fourth man in the midst of the fiery furnace. In Hosea, he is my love that is forever faithful. In Joel, he baptizes us with the Holy Spirit. In Amos, he's our burden bearer. In Obadiah, our Savior. And in Jonah, he is the great foreign missionary that takes the word of God into all the world. You go on and you see in Micah, he is the messenger with beautiful feet. And in Nahum, he is the avenger. In Habakkuk, he is the watchman that is ever praying for revival. In Zephaniah, he is the Lord mighty to save. In Haggai, he is the restorer of our lost heritage. In Zechariah, he is our foundation. And in Malachi, he is the Son of Righteousness with healing in his wings. In Matthew, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. In Mark, he is the miracle worker. In Luke, he's the Son of Man. And in John, he is the door by which every one of us must enter. In Acts, he is the shining light that appears to Saul on the road to Damascus. In Romans, he is our justifier. In 1 Corinthians, our resurrection. In 2 Corinthians, our sin bearer. In Galatians, he redeems us from the law. In Ephesians, he is our unsearchable riches. In Philippians, he supplies our every need. And in Colossians, he's the fullness of the Godhead bodily. In 1 and 2 Thessalonians, he is our soon coming king. In 1 and 2 Timothy, he is the mediator between God and man. In Titus, he is our blessed hope. And in Hebrews, he's the blood of the everlasting covenant. In James, it is the Lord that heals the sick. In 1 and 2 Peter, he is the chief shepherd. In Jude, he is the Lord coming with 10,000 saints. And in Revelation, lift up your eyes, church, for your redemption draweth nigh. He is King of kings and Lord of lords.
Yeah.
Amen. Did y'all enjoy that? Thank you, Frank. Thank you, Susie. Everybody did a great job, Lois. Thanks for leading that. No other name but the name of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Is worthy of glory, worthy of honor, and worthy of praise. Wonderful words of life.
Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Father, we thank you for that grace that is greater than all our sins. And we thank you for the knowledge that we can know you, how great you are, and that you love us. And we thank you for all the blessings you've poured out for us. As we give back a small portion, Father, we pray that you will bless these and use them in your will. And Father, that we might glorify you, we pray that you'll be with our worship. Be with Ronnie as he brings your word, that our hearts might be touched. We ask these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
To be your witness, you can take what's wrong and make it right. Day stars shine down on me, let your love shine through me in the night. Well, Lord, I see a world that's dying, wounded by the master of deceit. And we're groping in the darkness, haunted by the years of past defeat. But then I see you stand near me, Lord, shining with compassion in your eyes. And I pray, Jesus, shine down on me. Let your love shine through me in the night. I'm what's wrong and make it right. Day stars shine down on me. Let your love shine through me in the night. In the
Let your light shine through me. It reminds me of one of my favorite scriptures. That's found in the 5th chapter of Matthew. It said, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify the Father which is in heaven." Amen? That's what God created us to do. That's why he's made us a Christian. That's why he's in our hearts and in our lives, is to be a representative of Jesus Christ coming out of us and through us in the Word of God. If you have your Bibles, I'd like for you to turn with me to Colossians, the 3rd chapter and verse 16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching, and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. May we pray together. Our precious Father, I thank you, God, for the Word of God. I thank you, Lord, that you give us something that we can use every day, and you abide in us as we abide in you through your Holy Scriptures. And Lord, I pray, God, that you will open your Word up to us today, and Lord, that we might hear your word, and God, that we may be stirred by your word, and Lord, that we might leave this place excited, serving you and serving others. Bless in this time together, I pray that you will lead it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Paul tells the people to do what? To get in the word of Jesus Christ. Is this the living word? Folks, listen, this is the most important book that you have. And you know, a lot of people tell me, well, God doesn't talk to me. You know, you're always saying God's talking to you, and God doesn't talk to me. What a nonsense is that? God doesn't talk to me. I said, when's the last time you've been in the Word? When is the last time that you got into the Word and really studied God's Word? A man came up to my office this morning, Mr. Smith's son. He was a deacon here years ago, and I buried his wife a little over a month ago, and he brought me some more books, because I told him how much I loved his father's library. And I want to tell you, this man was a man of God. He was a man that searched out the scriptures. I take his Bible and I read through it all the time. I was able to find it, you know, kind of cast in a corner someplace. And I began to read it. And he has literally gone through the Word of God and is a self-taught, was a self-taught theologian. You could tell that by what he had written. So I was excited about that. And I read his notes. Somebody said, why are you keeping his notes? I said, because it's good. People said, Ronnie, when are you going to start preaching better sermons? And I say, when they start writing them. Folks, listen, the Word of God. Man, folks, we have the Word of God in our hearts. And it's a light unto our path, a lamp unto our feet, that we might not sin against God. See, a lot of people say, hey, listen, you know, I don't get anything out of church. I don't get anything out of doing anything except what I want to do. Folks, listen, get in the Bible and you'll get something out of it. You talk about church unity in the Bible. Right? Isn't that what it said? Isn't that what it said in that verse? He says, you're going to be teaching each other, admonishing one another. See, I feel that we need to get into that. We need to get into God's Word. This is God's Word to us. This is God's Word that we might understand it and that we might rightly divide the Word of truth. This Bible is the truth. And God wants, it demands our full attention. Man, I study quite a bit, and when I study, and I've been a student of the Word almost all my life. I was raised in the church. I know all the books when I was real young and knew most of the verses. People say, why don't you cut away from that King James Version? Because I memorized everything in the King James Version. You know, I can't get away from it because that's what I know and that's what I'm about. People say, why do you teach out of the King James Version? Because that's what I cut my teeth on. Those thous and whereas and all that kind of stuff. But folks, listen. We need to get in God's Word, and I've studied it and I look at it. But folks, listen, every time I open this great book, I learn something new. I learned something exciting. The most exciting thing you can do for yourself is to get in the Word of God. And some of us read it and study it haphazardly. When we get a chance, when we get time, when we get around to it. Oh, Zig Ziglar, he just passed away not too long ago, and he had a round to it. Because he said, every time we say, when I get around to it, he says, now you got around to it, now do it. Amen? And that's the reason, that's the way we need to get in God's Word. See, I want to say a few things about God's Word. Now, I've reorganized my notes now that I type the scriptures where I can really read them and not wear my glasses. But when I look at the passage of scripture that is found here in verse, well, I'm in a wedding right now. I had a wedding this week too. So got to the wedding, and when it said Seth and Tamara, do you take each other? Well, anyhow. In Psalms 119, it says, "The word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against God." See, folks, listen. Do you want to get rid of the sin in your life? Maybe not. I didn't hear anybody go, "Whoa, yeah, I do." I just kind of hear silence. Do you want to get rid of the sin in your life? Then get in God's word and hide yourself in Him, and He will keep you pure and clean. But you better watch it. When you start getting in God's word, Satan's going to nip at your heels. When you start doing something, you start getting in God's word, Satan's going to try to give you all kinds of excuses not to get in God's word. And he's going to bring all kinds of problems and difficulties and cast them at your feet. Because that's the way Satan works. But you got to say, because you are reading from God's word, you got to say, "Hey, listen, I'm not going to get discouraged. I'm not going to get disappointed because I have the word abiding in me." Amen? You see, it's the inspired word of God. I like what it says here. 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction, and righteousness. Folks, listen, the word of God is going to teach us how to be righteous. Do we need to be taught how to be righteous? You see, the word of God is so important to us. I don't believe that we understand how important it is. It's going to lead us to righteousness. And folks, listen, I believe that it's the inspired, infallible, inherent word of God. I believe it from cover to cover and almost the maps. I believe that that's good. And in contextual form, there is no mistakes. And I use the word contextual form because there are a lot of people take scripture out of context to prove anything. But folks, listen, I believe that God's word is a treasure. Where's your Bible at right now? Okay, you got it. Most of you got it. Where is it at your house? I have a Bible in every room, just in case. Just in case. I mean, every room. Just in case. I want to read God's word. I want to be, you know, if Satan attacks me, I want to be ready to fight Satan through the power of God. That's another thing. He gave us his word to be a defense. Ephesians 6, 17. "And take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God." Now, he was talking about putting on the whole armor of God. And he's saying, if you are going to stand, and folks, listen, we are in a spiritual battle. Did you know that? We're in a spiritual battle. In our country today, in our world, and where we live, Satan is trying to destroy us. He's trying to destroy the church, and we are in a spiritual battle, and we do not fight against flesh and blood, but principalities, things in high places. And he says, if we are going to stand, we must stand with the salvation of God, with the relationship with God. We have to have that relationship with God through the person of Jesus Christ. And then when we have that relationship, then God's word becomes alive. That's it. It becomes alive, and it's a two-edged sword, the Bible says. It's our equipment to fight Satan with? What did Jesus do every time he was tempted by Satan? What did he do? He quoted the Bible. He quoted God's word. And he was able to resist, and he showed us what we ought to do. You know, I tell you what, I'm having a hard time. Y'all gonna have to pray for me, okay? I'm having a hard time with my health lately. And I guess it's just been too much of that cake and cookies. And every time I go see somebody, they always have cake and cookies. And of course, I don't want to hurt their feelings. And so, you know, I'm not going to do that, you know. But now, folks, listen, and my wife's already put it on out there anyhow, so I might as well. You know, I can't have sweets. And that's hard for me. Because I'm not normally sweet, so I got to get sweet by eating sweets. And you know, you're going to have to pray for me because I'm having to fight that, but I've decided that I can fight that through the word. Every time I get tempted with chocolate cake, what's God say? Amen? What'd God say? I am the temple of the Lord. That's right. I have God living inside me. I am his temple. Is that what the word of God says? Then I got to take care of it. Hello? Now he's done, quit preaching, gone to meddling now. See, folks, listen. We need, as Christians, we need to be caught up in the word of God. We've got to be caught up in what God has to say for us, to us. The word of God is my strength. Christians today, you know, they're going through the motions of being a Christian because they're going through the motions of reading their Bibles. What happens when you read your Bible? I read my Bible, the Holy Spirit's there. Right? And the Holy Spirit begins to work in my life. And the Holy Spirit begins to show me some things through reading of God's word. And then the Holy Spirit shows me what that scripture says and what that scripture means and how I need to apply that in my life, in my heart. That's why we call it a living God, a living word. Let me put this down because I don't want you to think this notebook's a living word. Amen? I mean, don't you get excited when you read God's word? Man, when you're reading God's word and you're studying God's word, and we've got some people here, Tom, you do a great job, and people enjoy you breaking the word for them in Wednesday night Bible study. Amen? But folks, listen, we need to open it every single day of our lives. It demands that, a commitment to it. You want to a closer walk to God, I want to tell you, then you got to communicate with him. Now, what is communication? It's two ways. There is a stimuli, and there's a receiver, right? And if you don't receive, you know, and you're always doing the stimulation, right? If you don't receive, then there's no communication happening. Would you say that would be true? If people, you know, today, I'm saying, you know, I want to communicate with you today, but in order, I have to stimulate you, right? By what I have to say, and you have to receive it. But if you're not receiving it, is it any good, or is it good communication, or is it even communication? Absolutely not if you're not listening and you're not receiving it. See, I think a lot of people pray, God, give me a closer relationship with you. Let your Holy Spirit, folks, we pray for that closer relationship, but we're not ready to put in the work that causes that close relationship. Do you hear what I'm saying? We want a closer relationship with God. We want to snuggle up to God, but we won't snuggle up in His Word. This is what He has to say to us. It's our lamp. It's our light. The Word of God is a light that brightens as we understand it. And we're convicted by the Holy Spirit, and it becomes alive. Excited. Folks, we've got to get excited about what God's... This is a tool. You know, and I'm going to say this, may get in trouble, but I'm going to say it and then be done with it. There's no reason to pray if you're not in the Word. Did you hear what I just said? That's how serious it is. You know, we want God to answer our prayers, but we're not snuggled up in the Word. We need the Word of God in prayer to work hand in hand together. Everybody say amen now. See, folks, and I think we ought to pray. But praying deserves an action. I think people pray all the time. Pray God to do this and pray God to do that. And that's good and that's well. God's going to do it. But what we don't is put any action with it. I got a little story in closing about the Word and prayer. There was this lady and she was praying that a beer joint in her city would burn down. And she would get up every morning and she'd check and that beer joint would still be there. So she asked her maid, she said, hey, sweetie, we've been together. I know you're a godly woman. I've been praying for this beer joint to be burned down and it's still there every morning. Would you covet with me and begin to pray for this beer joint to be burned down? And she said, yes, ma'am. So they prayed that day together, and that lady prayed the night, jumped up the next morning, and the beer joint was gone. It was burned to the ground. And the lady went over to her maid and she said, "What? How did that happen? We just started this last night and look what God has done. How did that happen?" And the lady smiled at her and said, "Someday, sometime, you have to put a little feet to your prayer." Now I'm not asking y'all to go burn down some beer joints. Don't get excited and say, "Oh, you're going to go burn." Brother Ronnie said, "Go burn down some beer joints." I'm saying, get in God's Word. It takes some feet. It takes some ability. It takes us giving it to God and then doing what He's called us to do. And that's to study, to show thyself approved unto God. A workman needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. The most exciting book that I have is the Bible. And people would agree with me, but it's the less used book in your bookcase. Do we need to change that? He said, if you're going to bring unity, in Colossians, he said, if you're going to bring unity, if you're going to be able to admonish people, if you're going to be able to reach people, then you need to get in the Word of God. You know, I've had some things going on this week, and I've just stopped, and I've looked at the Word. When those things are going on, and God speaks to my heart, my life. And He gives me stability. The Word of God. It's time we read it. It's time we open it. And it's time we get on our knees and say, God, speak to me. Speak to me. And then open that Bible and let God and the Holy Spirit direct our lives. Our Father, I thank you for your holy word. From Genesis to Revelation. God, I thank you, God, that your grace was sufficient for us. And Lord, that your Spirit lives in us. And Lord, that you make us servants through your word. Lord, I pray, God, that we will open your word and let your word touch our hearts. God, people, even me, many times pray, God, I want more of you. To get more of you, we need more of your word. The inspired, infallible word that you have for us. Lord, I pray, God, that as we go into this time of invitation, that people will come, rededicate their life to you to read your word. Or if they need to join this congregation, that they may come. Whatever you're speaking to people about, would you do it right now? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we stand together, we're going to sing Just As I Am. As we sing Just As I Am, you come just as you are. And God will work in your life. Just as I am. Surrender to him. One more verse, then we'll close. Are you tossed about with many conflicts? Just come as you are. Amen. Thank you for being here today. We will have a business meeting. I did figure out today during the service, I was sure glad that God never called me to be a music director. I'm glad he called me to preach. And I almost called some people to fill in, and I said, no, I can do it. And I thought, I picked some of the hardest songs today. And so anyhow, I got paid back for that. But anyhow, you be praying for us. Pray for Pam, that she'll get well, Pam Dowdy, and she'll be back with us. Again, excitement. The choirs are getting together. The music sounds good. And so y'all be a part of that. Yes, Mary? Okay, and we'll do that immediately. I quit before 12 today. Y'all make a note of that, all right? No choir rehearsal this afternoon. Next Sunday, we'll get started back. Thank you, brother. All right.
Let's go to our Lord in prayer. Well, Father God, I thank you for Pastor Ronnie and the way you use him, Father God, to just give us your word, Father God. We thank you for being with those that are ill, Father God, for being with those that are in recovery, Lord God, just comfort them at this time, Father God. Go throughout this week with us, Father God. Bring us closer to you in a relationship, Father God, that others will see and question. And give us those words, Father God, to introduce them to you, your Son, your grace, and your mercy. Father God, we thank you for this day, and we lift it up to you in your glory. In Christ's name, amen.